Today I'm going to talk about how Aavegotchi leverages the EIP-2535, also known as the Diamond Standard. Just before I start, I want to make a quick poll. How many of you have an idea of what EIP-2535 is? Cool. And how many of you have no idea what Aavegotchi is? Oh, cool, interesting, what I was expecting. So for those of you who have been following, we have been able at Pixelcraft Studio, who is the main developer of Aavegotchi, we have been able to ship a lot of upgrades to our contracts. And I think the use of this EIP is our little secret in shipping all these upgrades regularly. So the love story between Cododan and Nick Mudge started about a year ago. Cododan is actually the Aavegotchi summoner, and Nick Mudge is the EIP author who also wrote other EIPs. Dan was planning to develop a very complex project, and one of the limits he was thinking of is a contract size limit. On Ethereum, you know, you are limited to 24 kilobytes contract size. So if you have a complex project, you will likely go above this limit. The project was actually so interesting that Nick joined Dan and became Aavegotchi CTO. And so, yeah, we are developing Aavegotchi. We are aiming to combine in a single project most of the culture, most of the facets from the Ethereum cultures, the DeFi degens, NFT nerds, gamers, yield farmers, and DAOists. So first, the NFT nodes and DeFi degens. And Aavegotchi is actually a classic NFT, ERC-721. But when you summon it, you need to stake a minimum amount of eight tokens in it. Eight tokens, you know, there are things like ADAI, AETH, AWIFI. It's a token that accrues interest in real time. When you summon your Aavegotchi, there are traits that are randomly generated. And this gives a rarity level to your Aavegotchi. And then there are some mini games that we call rarity farming seasons. The rarer your Aavegotchi, the more money it will draw from actually most of the sales revenue are redistributed back to the players or to the DAO. And to improve your rarity score, you can dress your Aavegotchi with some rare balls, which are ERC-1155. So it's a bit like Ben's presentation. An Aavegotchi is a kind of a basket which can contain ERC-20, 721, and 1155. And that actually generates passive income. The main idea behind developing Aavegotchi is to build a game. We just released last month our light paper of the Gochiverse, our version of the metaverse. We have already seen a few developers joining our project and developing their own mini games, like Pac-Man, Space Invader, using all the assets that are all on chain from Aavegotchi. And basically, in our metaverse, we will build a crypto version of Clash of Clans with some Farmville mechanics, tower defense, some aspects from civilization. And we will try to combine all this in a single project. We introduce the concept of land-bearing interest. You will be able to buy a parcel, and on your parcel, you will be able to buy, to build some structures, to upgrade your structures. And for that, you will need to pay with some resources that will be generated on your parcels. So you will need to mine your resources. We are going to build a DEX so that you will be able to exchange resources. If you provide liquidity to that DEX, you will earn another token, which is called Glamour, and that you will be able to use to accelerate construction time. And generally, we have had a lot of yield farming opportunities, and we will keep them coming. So Aavegotchi is governed by a DAO. Originally, it was only governed by the Ghost token. It's our token that we use to buy portals, Aavegotchis, wearables, consumables or parcels. You can earn ghost by having a very rare Aavegotchi in the rarity farming seasons. You can earn ghost also by participating in the governance process. Every time you vote to a decision, you get some experience, and then you get some ghost back. And also, if you play in the mini games regularly, we have some contest, and if you rank well, you can earn some ghost as well. One of the problems we faced is that some of our members were, I think, too much into Aavegotchi, and they sent all their ghosts to buy Aavegotchi's wearables, and they didn't have any more voting power. So I think we're the first DAO that introduced voting power based on your assets that you have. So if you don't have any ghosts, but you have Aavegotchi's and wearables, you still have some voting power, and your voice counts. So what are the problems that you are going to face when you want to build such a complex project? Well, the first one I already talked about is the contract size limit. 24 kilobytes is not that much. Right now, the Aavegotchi source code are 144 kilobytes. So you would need to split your code into different contracts, at least 6, maybe 7. Then you will have to deal with your with multiple addresses and multiple Ethereum addresses with your web interface. It will be a nightmare, you know, for all the integration and testing work. New devs also will have likely some trouble getting in your project. They will have to deal with all these addresses. Likely some spaghetti code as well. At least it's a risk to have some. And every time you will want to make some updates or upgrades, you will need to redeploy the whole project, and it's kind of complicated. And there comes the daemon standard, which aims to solve all these problems, but also bring more on the table. So basically, the daemon standard introduces a contract that we call the daemon contract. It's a small contract that implements a fallback function. And actually, this contract gets all his external functions from other contracts that we call facets. You can create as many facets as you want, and actually, it makes your code more organized, because every time you have to do something, you make a small facet, and in each facet, you try to make only one thing, but to do it as good as possible. So virtually, you have no contract size limit. Only your facet needs to be under 24 kilobytes, of course. You have only one Ethereum address, the one from your daemon contract, and then you get all the external function from the facet directly. It is gas efficient, especially for the most complex project. And it also introduces two tools. The first one is the loop. The loop lets you see what is inside the daemon. So what are the different facets? What are the different functions that are implemented? What are the Ethereum address, this kind of stuff. And it also introduces the daemon cut, which is a function that emits events every time that you make a change or modification to a facet or a function. So it makes all the upgrade history much more transparent. And finally, it really facilitates all the upgrades. If you want to add a new functionality, you can just edit your facet and redeploy only that facet, or you can create a new facet and you redeploy only that part of your code. Your Ethereum address don't change, your UI just say mostly the same. So how did we implement this in Aavegotchi? Of course, all our source code is online on GitHub. We have three directories. All our source code, all our functions are in the facets directory. You have interface and libraries. And initDaemon, that is a small contract that we call when we deploy the DAO. So, it's only a 60-line code. You have all your imports at first. You create your contract. Then you create a storage variable in which you will actually fit all the variables that will need to be accessed by the facets. So like the DR address, the pixel craft address, anything that you need to access in your functions. And here, this is the diamond contract. Actually, it's a bit special because Aavegotchi is both deployed on Ethereum and Polygon. So we created a shared folder in which we have our diamond contract. And it's even shorter. You see 40 lines. So you just import your diamond libraries. You create your diamond, your constructor. And here you have your fallback function. And every time that you call your diamond contract, this function executes the function that is called and returns the value of it. And finally, here is actually our source code, our tools and functions. So we have here 16 Solidity files. The first one is the Aavegotchi facet. So here we describe it. It's ERC721. We describe the mechanic to mint it. They have six trades. This kind of stuff is implemented there. In the second one, we have the Aavegotchi game. So far, the game is to pet your gochi. You know, it sounds like Tamagotchi. And every 12 hours, you need to pet your gochi so that he's happy. And earn some kinship points that also gets you some money at rarity farming events. The third contract is interesting. I will not describe them all, just doing a quick overview. But the third contract is interesting. It's the bridge facet. It's something that we are not planning actually when we deployed the contract. We are ready to deploy on December last year. And if you remind, the gas was gas costs were really high. A petting operation was about $50. So if you pet twice a day for a whole year, the price of a nice car. And we actually deployed on Polygon early January. So we had to create a bridge from Ethereum to Polygon, for example, to bridge the eight tokens, which are kind of complicated because they accrue interest in real time. So you need to describe all this mechanic in the contract. Then we created the bridge back from Polygon to Ethereum for the Aavegotchis, for the wearables, this kind of stuff. We have a facet for the DAO, we have a facet for the collateral. Same thing when we deployed on Polygon. There were not a lot of things back in January, and there was no NFT marketplace deployed there. So we created a marketplace, and actually we did two contracts because we have two kind of ERCs, and we don't want to mix, you know, functions that might be similar. And actually, you see the logic. You just implement as many Solidity files as you want. We have like SVG facet, which loads all the SVG from the blockchain. The VRF facet for Chainlink random function, this kind of stuff. So yeah, throwback to a year ago, it sounds like our Aavegotchi Samoanov actually was a bit worried in the beginning, thinking it would be an overkill, but frankly, all the devs that I've spoken to that have already worked with the Daemon standard, they are all very optimistic about it. It's a clean way and elegant way to write your code. And actually, it's not something we would advise to beginner developers. If you are starting to learn Solidity, maybe get first some experience with it. And then when you want to build some more complex thing, I think it will be really helpful. And you will actually earn a lot of time by using it. So a quick overview of some projects building with this EIP. We are not aware of all of them, but we counted at least 20 projects so far. So the most famous one are maybe pieDAO, gelato, and BarnBridge. pieDAO is an index protocol. Gelato network helps you automate your smart contract, and BarnBridge tokenizes the risk in DeFi protocol. There are some DEXs also deploying using this standard, DerivaDEX for the derivative, and DOTC for OTC deals. And the University of Ljubljana is doing something different. They are developing a smart contract platform for 5G multi-tenant applications. So thanks for your attention. If you want to know more about this, I really encourage you to read the IP itself. There are a lot of things that I didn't take the time to describe. There is a Discord server in which you will find many members developing using this EIP. You will find also Nick Mudgen there, the EIP author, who is always helpful. He made different implementation of the diamond using Hardhat with different parameters. You can use that to have a quick start on it. And Austin Griffith made a killer tutorial on its scaffold called the Diamond Starter Kit. You will be able to find it on YouTube. Thank you.
Any question?
How well is the diamond pattern supported by like indexers and Etherscan and so on? Like, is it easy to explore? Because I mean, the address you're interacting with is the diamond,
yep.
Right? Yeah. So like proxies are pretty well supported, but how about diamonds?
Yeah. Basically, the diamond standard is very similar to proxies, but the thing with proxies, at least to my understanding, is that you only have one facet. And with the diamond standard, you can have as many facets as you want. If you want to explore what is inside a diamond, you can use the loop. There is a website called looper.dev in which you have some projects and it explores them. And yeah, you can use a polygon scan to explore our contracts or our resource scan. And yeah, it's the pleasure. Okay, thanks.